Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. After my pep talk about the topic of nakedness in privacy, one thing jumped up and made me realize that the deep impact of the cultural Islam is going to prove difficult to unroot. But inshallah, with hard work, sabr, and a good deal of trust and support from Allah, someday a future generation, then generations after it, will enjoy the Islam like we have never ever knew ourselves in this current time here. And that is because the element of culture is so deepened and so deeply rooted in people that when you say something, even if I bring Al-Quran, the Quran is brought in, and the explanations are brought in, still there is an element of doubt, and people have a tendency. And your reactions about what I am saying is a great proof. So in this follow-up pep talk, I will take two elements that I am going to talk about. One of them is speaking about the dog. Is it halal in Islam or haram to have a dog as a pet? And also I will speak about eating with the right hand and the left hand. And after these two pep talks, inshallah, you will have and you will be much more better equipped with a lot of things that are going to help you in your journey back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And always remember, my dear sisters and my brothers, in your mind you have intelligence. So open your mind and let that intelligence shine. Allah has praised the mind of a human being countless times in Al-Quran, over 90 times directly, almost infinite times indirectly. And after all, Adam alayhi salam, when he was taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the nouns of everything, the housing of that knowledge was the mind. Don't belittle your mind. In this life and in this world and in anything that exists today or has existed at any one time or in point in time in the past, or will exist in the future, there will always be certain things that are absolutes, constants. They will never ever change. While there will always be other things that will change, and they are variables and also relatives. So please keep this notion of constant and variables in mind, as you will need them greatly, because Al-Islam works with these kind of things. Even in Al-Islam, we have something called al-thawabit, and these are the constant things that will never, ever change in Al-Islam. And we also have the variables that will change with the times, with the people, with the circumstances, and everything. And I give just a brief example. Allah is one. This is a constant that will never, ever change. Belief in the angels is a constant. Fasting Ramadan is a constant. Hajj is a constant, and so on and so forth. These are constants that will never ever change. But variables, they will change based on times and circumstances. And this is exactly what Al-Quran has been teaching us. Therefore, the topic of absolutes, non-changeables, and relatives, variables, or constants is a very important component in the application of Islam. Our scholars, Allah have mercy on them, have named this topic, as I already mentioned, al-thawabit. Al-thawabit are those things that do not change, are constant, and unquestionably always stable. Al-mutaghayyirat are the changeables, the variables, and those things that move with time. Sometimes they are okay, at other times they are not okay. Here is an example to illustrate this concept. Temperature, for example, at different times of the day is a variable, and it is always represented in the world of math as an X. In other languages, it could take another letter or another form. However, the characteristics of iron, which form the iron itself, are constant. They do not change. And this is why we have iron. The minute one of those characteristics change, then iron is no longer iron. In algebra, however, a constant is a number on its own, or sometimes a letter, such as A, B, C, to stand for a fixed number. And here is an example to illustrate how constants and variables work in algebra. Let's take the example of this equation here. X plus 4 equals 6. 4 and 6 in this equation here are constants. They will always mean 4 and 6. They will never ever change into something else. 6 will never mean 7. It will always mean 6. And as such, these are constants. But the x in this equation here is the variable. And as such, it can affect the outcome of the equation. In our example, when we say x plus 4 equals 6, you could say that x equals 2. And in this case here, 2 plus 4 equals 6. But then again, because x is a variable and we gave it a value of 2, if we were counting, for example, the demographic representations in a Muslim country, we could say that x equals 1 husband plus 4 wives equals 6 children. And as you can see here, 4 remained 4 because it's a constant, it doesn't change. 6 remained 6 because it's a constant, it doesn't change. What changed is the variable. And the variable in this case here, we replaced it by 1, the husband, who marries 4 women, produces 6 kids. In Islam, it's extremely important that you understand what are the constants in Islam that do not change, that do not accept any bargain at all whatsoever, regardless of when, and those variables that are debatable. And this is how we are going to look at the issue here of taking a dog as a pet and eating with the left hand or the right hand. What the scholars have said, what the Quran says, and how can we work with this information today in the West here. First of all, is the issue of having a dog a constant or a variable? Some school of thoughts have made it a constant. It's something that we never ever change. However, there are others that have said, no, hang on, this is a variable. And with time, circumstances and conditions of people, the having of a dog as a pet can change. So let's see which of these two guys is on the right path. There is, however, one constant that has been overlooked throughout the centuries. And that constant is that Islam is for mankind as a whole. It's a universal religion. It was not, it is not, and it will not be for a specific people that belong to a specific country or a specific era. So this point here is extremely, extremely important. And I am going to start with you from the very first beginning for this issue of the prohibition of having a dog as a pet, how the ahadith that were mentioned, in what circumstance were they mentioned, and also we'll take the point of view of the Quran, and then bi-idhnillah come up with a conclusion. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah, he found it infested by rogue and homeless dogs. There was even some sort of an epidemic. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, due to his leadership and high status as a chief commander, whose primary function as a leader is to protect and secure the well-being of his people, he ordered them, i.e. the Sahaba, the companions, and the inhabitants of Al-Madinah, to put all dogs to sleep. The command was one, put dogs to sleep. In Sahih Muslim, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu narrates, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَمَرَ بِقَتْلِ الْكِلَابِ, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has ordered to kill dogs, or to be more civilized, we're going to say to put them to sleep. In another narration by Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he says, أَمَرَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ بِقَتْلِ الْكِلَابِ, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us and ordered us to kill dogs. حتى إن المرأة تقدم المدينة من البادية بكلبها, even though a woman would come to Al-Madinah from her own village with her dog, فنقتله, then we kill it. I.e. the Sahaba would kill the dog of that lady. ثم, then, نهى رسول الله عن قتلها, then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم forbade from the killing of dogs. So as it is, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم comes to Al-Madinah, sees the Al-Madinah infested with an abundant number of great dogs. Some of them were harmful, some of them were rogue, some of them were, as you know, dogs are. So sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wanted to curb that great number, and he commanded the Sahaba to kill any dog, even if people came from outside Al-Madinah, they would still kill that dog, radiallahu anhu. In another version of a hadith, still in Sahih Muslim, Abdullah ibn Umar reports, أَمَرَ بِقَتْلِ الْكِلَابِ Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has commanded the killing of dogs, إِلَّا كَلْبَ صَيْدٍ except a dog for hunting, أَوْ كَلْبَ غَنَمْ or a shepherd's dog, أَوْ مَاشِيَةٍ or cattle. فقيل لابن عمر, so it was said to Ibn Umar, إِنَّ أَبَا هُرَيْرَةَ يَقُولُ أَوْ كَلْبِ زَرْعٍ Abu Huraira was telling also on top of this version, or a dog of a crops, fields that protects the crops and the fields. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said, إِنَّ لِأَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ زَرْعًا That's because Abu Huraira owns a field with crops and things like that. As you can see in this example here, to avoid further growth of unattended and dangerous dogs, his command was clear, kill dogs. And in case someone attacks the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam as to how comes this man is full of compassion and mercy and all that kind of stuff, kills dogs, that is very inhumane. And these dogs are really innocent animals, and why should they be killed? Or someone might label Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as not being an animal lover or stuff of that ilk. The answer is that Islam is a practical religion, not an emotional religion. Just like democracy or any other governing ideology out there. But when human lives are under threat, then sacrifices have to be made and somebody has got to pay the price, which in this case here happens to be dogs or rats or pigeons or crops or anything out there. The decision to take the lives of these harmful animals can be taken by anyone, even if that person was a huge, great animal lover. It's painful in the heart, but it's something that's got to be done. And that is where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. Something had to be done about this great number of dogs that were just scattered in Al-Madinah and posing a real danger, both at safety and health threats. It is in that putting dogs to sleep scenario that the famous and well-known hadith about the prohibition of taking dogs as pets were said. Except obviously as necessity. But at the very first beginning, all dogs must be killed. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade the taking of dogs as pets. Abu Hurairata radiallahu anhu narrates, and he narrates one version of this prohibition. There are other and many other hadith. Each hadith has got bits here and bits there, but this hadith here is comprehensive. It has the prohibition and the exemptions at the same time. He said radiallahu anhu, من اقتنى كلبا, whoever takes a dog that is not a hunting dog or a cattle dog or a field's dog, فإنه ينقص من أجره قراطان كل يوم. Every day he will lose of his rewards two قراطs. One قراط is the sixth of a element. For example, if you have 24,000 good deeds on a daily basis, and that is 1,000 good deeds per hour, one qirat is 1/6 of that, and it means 4,000 good deeds will be taken away from the reward of a person who takes a dog as a pet. Qiratan means 8,000 good deeds will be lost every 24,000 good deeds. So this is just an approximation, and only Allah knows exactly what a qirat is. In another version of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he goes, من اقتنى كلبا إلا كلب ماشية أو دار, whoever takes a dog, except a shepherd's dog or a protective dog, نقص من عمله قراطان, two qirats or good deeds will be deducted from his daily work. Now, before I move on a little further, have you noticed how Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu did not mention a dog for fields? And when he was asked about it, he said that is because Abu Huraira has fields. That's why he added the dog. Even though the hadith, they say that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that. And this is exactly a clear example how the Sahaba hear Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say something, and then they give their own interpretations. So basically today, when it comes to defining what is halal and haram in owning dogs, scholars will tell you, you can own a dog for shepherds, protection, and if you have fields. Why is that? Because Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu has added the two words unfilled dogs because he has fields. And as you can see, this is a real clear example on how the Sahaba listen to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, interpret what he says, and they give us the meanings. I wish, really wished, they only transmitted what he exactly said, not their understanding. And then the scholars go on, explain the understanding of a Sahabi, and we end up with a lot of things in our Islam that were initially not part of. Since we are people who want to use the intelligence that Allah has given us, we can ask a few questions when it comes to this matter here. Question number one. Was the prohibition of taking dogs as pets due to avoiding the invasion of rogue dogs again? And as such, is it a constant, that means non-changeable, that will always remain? Or is it a variable, circumstantial conditions until we are sure that we are not going to be inundated and invaded by dogs again? So let's take the two concepts and applying them internationally, since Islam is for mankind. Let's take England. Scenario number one. Dogs are uncontrolled, roam free in the streets, are dirty, sick, vicious, hungry, and pose a constant dangerous hazard to the public. As a response to this exceptional condition, the British government runs a campaign called Clean England of Bad Dogs. To help the success of this campaign, the government imposes a fine penalty on any who pets a dog without a valid reason. This would be something that the public will abide to and honor. But does this mean dogs will always be prohibited because of a circumstantial law of 20 years ago? In other words, when England has cleared all the streets of London from all bad dogs and after a couple of years everything is under control, does that mean dogs will always be forbidden in London? The logical answer is no, it won't. Because as soon as the prohibition reasons go away, things go back to the norm. Don't we say everything on earth is halal unless prohibited by a text for a conditional reason forever? This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored the dog in His Quran, and He honored that dog eternally for its protective and gentle side. This is clearly mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, ayah 18, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَاذًا وَهُمْ رُقُودٍ. And you would think of them, of those youth that ran away from their people and hid in a cave. And you would think of them as awake. وَهُمْ رُقُودٍ. When in fact, they are very asleep. وَنُقَلِّبُهُمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينِ وَذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ. And we turn them and we toss them to the right and to the left. وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِطٌ ذِرَاعَيْهِ بِالْوَصِيدِ. And their dog stretching its four legs at the entrance, just like dogs sit. لَوِ اطَّلَعْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Had you found them, or had you found where they are, then لَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِرَارًا. You would have run away. وَلَمُلِئْتَ مِنْهُمْ رُعْبًا. And you would have been filled with terror of them. Now the question is, if Allah did not mention the dog, would the meaning of the ayah have changed? Absolutely not. I am going to read back the meaning of the ayah in English. In the first one, I am going to leave the mention of the dog in that meaning. And a second time, I'm going to take away the dog so that we see if the meaning of the ayah changes or not. And you would think of them as awake, yet they are very, very asleep. And we turn them to the right and to the left. And their dog stretching his four legs at the entrance. Had you found them or seen them, you would have run away and terror would have filled you. So this is with the dog, now without the dog. And you would think of them as awake, yet they are very, very asleep. And we turn them to the right and to the left. Had you found them or seen them, you would have run away and terror would have filled your heart. As you can see, it absolutely changes no meaning at all. Especially that in the second one, it speaks about the inhabitant of the cave, the youth, the young man that hid there. So why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention the dog when he was talking about the people. Because the dog was sleeping in the courtyard, he was not sleeping with them. Allah is just. Allah was thankful to a dog that followed the people of belief and stuck with them in their darkest moments. He eternalized the dog, but at the same time, he showed us where the dog should be. And that dog should be in the yard. And this is why mankind, in their instinct thinking, usually leave the dog outside in the garden in a nicely built niche for the dog. That niche is where the dog was lying out. Isn't that beautiful? Also, notice how Allah attributed the dog to them. And he referred to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, as their dog. They are a bunch of kids, young men, and one of them owned the dog. Some scholars said the dog didn't belong to any of them, it just followed them. So ask yourself, why did Allah attribute the dog to them? Because he was them for a mission, the oneness of Allah, it's a matter of belief. In the ayah of the dog in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah hinted again to an etiquette, a middle balance act about the dog. The young men were sleeping inside, the dog was sleeping outside. This goes 100% with what people who take a dog for a function. They always build its niche and keep it out there, well-fed, well-watered, well-protected from cold, and that is that. My dear sisters and my brothers, open your minds. There is intelligence in it, as I said earlier on. Your mind has been praised by Allah countless times. Because the world is changing. Humanity is changing. Education is changing. Perception is changing. And so are convictions and beliefs as well. We can't stop the progress of the world just for it to fit the original copy of Al-Islam of 1,400 years ago. We can't praise the world and humanity because of intelligence and rebuke them for not staying in the past. We can't. We can't tell the people well done for being intelligent and then rebuke them for asking questions when they want to understand more as to why what we do in Al-Islam is done the way we do it and the reason behind it. Every human being has the right to ask any question about our Islam, and we cannot answer them, take this as it is, that's because that. No way, Jose. Al-Islam in Surah Fussilat, in the detailed explained on how Allah speaks about the Quran, Al-Quran is fully explanative and explains everything and answers every question a human might have to ask. Yet, as I have said once, history is completely alienated, and Muslims, we don't read and we don't look at history. We don't study it to avoid the pitfalls of others that they fell in. The synagogue and the church have tried to control people in the past, and they succeeded for centuries, but eventually humanity caught up with them, rejected their controlling techniques, and rebelled further against them. And then the synagogue and the church started cutting corners, making compromises, and lowering their standards just to be accepted again and even believed in for a little to a certain degree. The Islamic masjids and centers are also in the same basket. Regardless of where this masjid or Islamic centers are, either here in England, in Saudi Arabia, in Mecca, or in Al-Madinah, or anywhere else on earth, if the masjid worldwide doesn't pay attention to how the synagogue and church fell on their faces, the same fate is awaiting this masjid. I have already given an example about how the church reacted to the rock and roll music back in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, and how they considered Elvis Presley as Satan and the devil. What has the church gained? Absolutely nothing. And it caused people to rebel against the church, and the church has never, ever recovered till today. The same thing, the synagogue has been on and on and on about the prohibition, about rock and roll music. What has that done? Jews created Hollywood and created the music industry and are making millions today. And the synagogue is now taking off their monies, but it cannot prohibit them. The masjid is doing the same error and the same mistake. It's forcing us, controlling us, and pushing us down until there will come one generation, and that generation is going to explode and is going to tell the masjid, no, we don't want to listen to you. And only then that the masjid will start making compromises. Today the masjid is guiltizing Muslims who don't go to the masjid. But the masjid never asks a question, what am I doing wrong that people are not coming to me? And this is the question for any reformers out there to follow and think through and see how they can change so people can change. It's like a business. People don't go shop from your business. Instead of taking a look at yourself, what you're doing wrong that has chased people away, you keep pointing fingers to the people. Then one day your business will collapse, and that is a certainty. This is a divine law. Regardless of that masjid, if it is in Mecca, Medina, or elsewhere in the world, the law is the law. As I mentioned, education is changing wherever you go, both in Muslim and non-Muslim countries. Here in England, Muslims are oblivious to a great danger and a very unnecessary danger for their children. To illustrate my point, I will cite the Highway Code as an example because in a sense it works exactly along the lines of Islam. And that is to serve people to get them to their final destination safe and sound. There are two types of people who use the Highway Code. Those who know the purpose of the code, understand it, and apply it. These are the best you can have and wish for on the road. The second type is those who use the highway code. They know a little about it, consider the highway code as a restricting burden to their freedom to do as they please on the road. They detach themselves from its purpose. And when alone or away from the surveillance cameras and speed cameras, they choose not to apply it. These are the worst you can have and don't wish for on the road. Many Muslims out there today belong to the second class. Of those who use Islam, know a little about it, consider Islam as a restrictive burden to their freedom. As a result, they detach themselves from its purpose, even though they are still counted as Muslims or as road users. And when alone and away from the human surveillance cameras, they chose not to apply Islam. And these are the dangerous road users or Islam users, and they pose the great danger as detrimental and vital as those who drive badly and don't respect the highway code. We all pay a heavy price for them being on our roads or being in our religion. Let me get back to the education dangers and how your child's school education will affect them in the long run. And I am going to take this time the dog as a tangible example. Your child goes to school, to an English public school, learns that animals are awesome and useful to mankind. To illustrate that example, the teacher takes the dog as an example. And one day your child learns the positive impact of a dog on a human's life. These impacts were not derived out of thin air, but after continuous researches ran throughout all kinds and types of professionals, from health benefits to psychological benefits, not to mention safety benefits and companionship. So your child one day comes home all excited about the wonderful day that he or she spent at home learning about the great animal that is the friend of mankind, a dog. And then he comes to you and tells you, dad or ma'am or whoever you are, today I've learned 10 great things about dogs. I am going to read them to you, and then you are going to help me with my homework and put all those 10 beautiful characteristics of a dog into a nice text. Then they'll say, number one, you'll exercise more. Number two, you'll feel less stressed. Number three, your social life can improve as you meet other dog lovers. Number four, cancer can be detected sooner due to the dog's amazing sense of smell. Number five, your children are less likely to have allergies. Number 6, your heart will be healthier. Number 7, you are less likely to feel depressed. Number 8, you can grow old gracefully and feel safe when home alone. Number 9, your risk for general illness decreases. And number 10, general feeling of safety is yours. And then the child is so excited and turns to you and says, help me with the homework, and you help your child. Then your child innocently asks, can we have a dog pet, please? And the most unexpected answer comes packaged in one piece, no, it's haram. Your child will accept this answer for a lack of a better choice. But the impact of this answer will travel with them throughout their lives. They will never ever be able to understand how the English boy or the French boy or the American boy sitting next to them, they have a dog and happy with the dog, they are not sick, they don't see anything different between them and that child who has a dog and themselves as to their religion, something that is dear to their hearts, prohibits them from having a dog. They will always see Islam as a restriction and a barrier. They will feel isolated and grow with a feeling of they don't belong here. This is why a lot of our youth, as soon as they realize that they can think for themselves, will rebel both on the parents and Islam. They will form a new family, a new religion called gangs. All this could have been and still can be avoided by learning to truly wash Islam from the old grips of men of religion and the past and stop applying other people's versions, other countries' version, and other cultures' version of Islam into our lives here in the West. But if your child excitingly brought to you the benefits of having a dog, and you said to them, the dog is a beautiful animal, Allah praised him in the Quran, and you take this as an opportunity to tell them the story of the people of the cave, and how Islam practically and beautifully deals with the dog, and how having a dog is no big deal as long as it lives in its own niche, is not a human being that lives with you inside the home. Otherwise, how can you explain to your child that the etiquette of having a dog is that it should have its sole utensils? He drinks in his own pot. Otherwise, what's the need of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the meaning of which it says, "Tahuri ina'i ahadikum," the purity and cleanliness of a plate or a pot of one of you, إِذَا وَلَغَ فِيهِ الْكَلْبِ, if a dog has drank from it, أَنْ يَغْسِلَهُ سَبْعَ مَرَّاتِ, that he washes it 7 times, أُولَهُنَّ بِالتُّرَابِ, the first of which is with the earth, clay or dust, whatever. Muslim, this is Sahih Muslim. If the dog was completely forbidden to be in our environment, why would Rasulullah ﷺ give us this hadith as a means to clear and clean our utensils that the dog has drank in them? He didn't say through that pot. And if the dog was completely alienated from our lives, why would Rasulullah ﷺ tell us if he drinks from your own pot? We have two choices. It's either we free our Islam from all extras and apply it to us here and now and live in the light, or keep borrowing from the past and from other countries and other school of thoughts and other scholars and other, and live in the darkness. Choice is completely yours. I am fully aware that there will be people there that are going to accuse me of rejecting the Sunnah, and I am not rejecting the Sunnah a bit. In fact, I am more believing in the Sunnah when it agrees with the Quran, and also when I ask questions. Has Rasulullah ﷺ really prohibited having dogs just because when he came to Al-Madinah, there was a huge number of them and he wanted to clean Al-Madinah all through? Or is this a constant that is eternal ruling in Islam, and every nation that wants to embrace Islam must be commanded to get rid of its dogs? I am begging of the great scholars of Islam to put their head without just reporting to us what XYZ said. We want fresh, new look at our Islam. We don't want XYZ 600 years ago or 9 centuries ago prohibited. Dogs at that time, they didn't have vets. Dogs at that time, they didn't have food in supermarkets and all superstores. Dogs in that time, they didn't have all these vaccines and all these things. There is a lot to be said about that. And one more point about having a dog as a pet is one great question that requires to be asked and answered. If it is permitted to take a wolf as a pet, why not a dog? There is a great agreement between the scholars of Islam today that it is halal to have a wolf as a pet, knowing that the dog is of the family of the wolves. Why is it halal to have a wolf as a pet and haram for a dog? And another question, why is it permitted to take a lion or a tiger or a cheetah as a pet that you can use for hunting and things like that, halal? And why a dog that you also can use for hunting and things like that, haram? You see, there are lots of peculiarities about the element of the dog. And I am starting to think that this is cultural and has traveled with us times, and nobody has dared to challenge this culture. And alhamdulillah, today we live in a time where we can challenge this cultural thinking. So we need a really an in-depth study of this element of taking a dog as a pet. Please, please, please don't call me a kafir or I reject sunnah. I don't all these things. I'm just tired of losing our children to certain things that are so trivial as taking a dog as a pet. The poor guy, the moment he opens his mouth, can I have a dog? Say it's haram. I would love to have a German shepherd or a husky dog or something like that that I can use, walk with and jog with at 3 o'clock in the morning. Or maybe a sister, you might in these times and things go walk with your dog in the street and you will be protected by Allah because he has made the dog for our service. This is, and so many other questions, we need to really look at them, these questions and these issues, right in the eyes to come up with the practical our time solutions, not their times solutions applied to us today. I so wanted to deal with the issue of eating with the right and left hand with this talk here, but it's just going to be a long talk. So I will stop here and inshallah dedicate a complete different talk to eating with the right hand and left hand. What is historical? What, just like we did with the dog today, ask intelligent questions and start finally loving Islam. You see, just like the highway code, when you understand why all those restrictions are on the street, when you see like 20 miles speed limit, 30 miles speed limit, don't go right, don't turn left, don't do this, don't do that. When you understand the purpose behind why they are here in this particular moment, you will enjoy driving because you become a positive player. You become part of those who make a difference. And then driving will be good and everything will be fine and you'll be safe and everything. But if you are just like the majority of people out there, as soon as they see 20 miles speed restrictions, they get angry and they drive at 30 miles. They don't care. These people cannot enjoy driving because they will always drive in fear that there is a camera, that there is something that has been done, that they're going to get a fine. We need our Islam to be like the first people. I want you and myself to be happy. When they tell me the dog is prohibited, I want to be happy about it. Not ask, oh, really? Oh, I wish I could have a dog and I wish this hadith wasn't there. This is a very dangerous thing. It really is. So we need to ask open, honest, and great questions to receive open, honest, great answers. And I pray to Allah that this pep talk here will open your eyes further to this beautiful religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I pray to Allah to bless us all and give us the best of this life and also help us get to the best of our religion. Wa sallallahum ala nabiyyina Muhammad. If you'd like to be part of my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp. Number is 0044 78 76 40 87 35. And you all be in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa salli allahumma ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanaka allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.